Now, I noticed that in the times when you had actually hit industry, industrial design was not that respectable or respected for that matter, because, you know, us Indians never used to build any products. We were outsourcing shops for cheap labor and stuff like that. So we'd get the low-end programming jobs, and products would never happen in India, and most of the products that you saw in India were not very interesting looking. Right? As far as automobiles go in those days, it was the Fiat, basically, the Premier Padmini and the Ambassador. Right? It's only recently that we have a need for good designers who can come up with a new Tata Nano or the Mahindra XUV 500 or our local vehicles. In fact, I'm told that most of the Maruti vehicles are designed here now, the Swifts on and all that, right? So there's a sea change which is happening in the Indian economy and in Indian industry. And this change is brought about by guys like Mr. Gokhale, who are there actually practitioners of the art of industrial design and bringing that kind of sensibility to the artifacts that we see around us. Okay. Now, something interesting also I've discovered is that design is not about just art, fart, kind of, you know, where you just make it look nice, where you just put a nice skin on a product and it becomes nice. Design is much deeper. And as you'll see from this talk, design, actually, engineers are blessed if they are also designers at heart, right? Because design means trying to solve, first of all, the right problem rather than a problem in a right way. Design is about solving the right problem. And it's the design sensibility which makes Steve Jobs a very interesting character, right? Rather than build an existing widget better, he goes to the heart of the problem and says, what do I want to do? How can I do it better? I want to listen to music. I want to listen to music in a seamless way. And so he comes up with an iPod and the iTunes store and then totally revolutionizes the entire paradigm of listening to music, wiping out the Walkmans and everything out of business, basically. Similar, he's trying with, why should I have to relate to the written word or to a computer through a laptop or a PC, right? Can I make it more intimate, the experience, right? So you have the iPad and the totally revolutionary interface that the iPad brings. So perhaps Satish this afternoon can bring us a bit of a flavor of what goes into sort of being an industrial designer and the kind of effect that we can have on industry through his own examples of the work that he's done. So Satish, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Kavi, for this opportunity. It's actually quite nice to come back to academic institutes. It's actually a selfish interest. One gets to refresh once again, you know, it's very important. I think Kavi first mentioned about problems, you know, the solving the right problems. To me, I think the most important part is identifying the problem. You've identified the problem, the solution is there. You know, so that's what we actually try and see, that what is the problem. So most of the projects, what we do is, as also Kavi just mentioned, there is design is not about just aesthetics, but design is about functionality. Design is about creating an experience, like what Steve Jobs has done. It's what he's designed, he's actually thrown an experience to all of us. I mean, it's an experience to actually use an iPod, an iPad. It's something which is totally revolutionized. And besides just throwing in an experience, he's actually also built an ecosystem for it. So what is required is you can't just throw in a design or you know, an idea, but you have to support it by having an infrastructure and ecosystem for it, which is extremely successful from what he has done. Just to give a very quick background, I'm a graduate of NID and I graduated in 1984, and that was a time nobody wanted design. I was invited to set up the design department at Bajaj Auto, where, as you know, we used to have the scooters and the auto rickshaws, that's all. So my first project, which as a fresh graduate, what we did was we worked on the rear engine rickshaw. Again, they were creating a comfort to the rider. The guy who's driving the rickshaw is in the rickshaw for 8 hours. We as passengers don't sit more than half an hour. I'm talking of 84. Now the distances have increased. The reach of auto rickshaws have increased, or the distances they travel have increased. So that's how the idea took birth. And that was the first rear engine rickshaw which was developed. With a very clear understanding in 84 when I joined Bajaj Auto, that 1988 is when I want to venture into my own business. Where I believe that as design or as designers, it's very important to work on varied projects and not just narrow down your focus on to a specific domain. So that was an advantage. And design is all about teamwork. You know, you would have computer guys here, the electronics people, the software people, the manufacturing teams, there could be a civil engineer on the project. It's very interesting to work as a team member. In fact, that's what we are doing now. So 88, you know, now, sorry, everyone talks about innovation. But since 88, we've been talking about managing innovations. Because we firmly believe that everyone has ideas. You give them the right platform, you actually come up with something very interesting. Just to cite a very simple example, should I switch off this light? It's just washing, because some of our work relates to color. See, one of the reasons why I believe that everyone has ideas is there were n number of engineers, you know, from IITs and you named the institute at Bajaj Auto, and Mr. Bajaj had announced a cash prize of 25,000 rupees for the guy who baptizes the new vehicle. So believe me, the guy who serves tea in our R&D department walked away with that 25,000 cash prize. Chetak was baptized by him. So I believe that, yes, everyone has ideas. Given the right platform, he can perform better. So since 88, we've been using this tagline called managing innovations. Because not every time you're going to innovate, but even a 1% increment in what is the prior art also makes a world of a difference at times. So what we do is we actually design products, graphics, interfaces, and the most important part is perceptions. People should know what the product is. People should say, look at me. The product should say, look at me, feel me, touch me, eventually buy me, and respect me as well. You know, so it's very important that's the unfortunate part in India. Most of the products, they perform well. You know, as engineers, they would always see that the performance is perfect. Without, you know, and ignoring the ergonomics, ignoring what the aesthetics, ignoring how it's going to be manufactured, what materials to be used. So we come in as a team member with the manufacturing teams as well. So most important part for us is the perceptions. And let's keep this very interactive. You can stop me anywhere and ask questions, so it becomes, the link doesn't get broken also. Now, I always believe that design is not a win-win situation. Everyone says it should be a win-win situation. But I believe it has to be a win-win and win. And the three stakeholders are our clients, the end user, and society at large. Eventually, design has to reach to the person who actually requires it. And all of us require design today. In our day-to-day life, I mean, I'm not talking of high-end products, but just a simple spoon can actually create a smile on your face if you like that spoon. What we do is actually, we try and create a bond between the man and machine, or let's say the equipment. It's very important that when I'm working with the equipment, I should feel comfortable to work with the equipment. I need not know how complex it is inside. You know, most of you are from the embedded group, I believe, right here? So, you know, whatever you do gets hidden. Unfortunately, that's where design comes even more important, that it should say I'm a high-tech product. Though the design can be very simple, but that wow element should come through simplicity. Because what you do is you put in a lot of logic inside. That's also very important. So the product should say there's a lot of logic in it. The product should say that I have made the user, you know, less of an issue while he's handling the equipment. That is very important. So the interface part also becomes very important. Just to quickly run through, there are a lot of D's in our design process. The most important in the last 15 years we've realized is we've invariably ended up redefining the design brief. Clients come to us not knowing what to expect from a designer. And we've ended up giving him a radically different product what he was asking for. End of the day, the most important part or the person is the user. So we're not designing it for the management of the company, but the guy who is going to use the equipment is what our target audience is. Okay, coming to some electronic products, I mean, one is, this is a product which is a WiMAX. It's designed for the person who actually invented the Pentium chip, Mr. Vinod Dham. He has floated a company called Telsima. And, oh, it's getting washed off. One second, I think that's the culprit, that tube light. No way to close it, no? It's visible? Oh, okay. That's not a problem at all. Okay. So this, we've actually designed two models for them. One is with an external antenna, one is with a built-in antenna. And the one which is launched in India is with the external antenna. But what you're seeing is, this is with a built-in antenna. See, the whole idea of all IT, ITSs and companies, they are typically the ACP aluminum clad buildings with glass and all that. So I wanted that kind of character in the product as well, because this is a totally IT, ITS related project. And here the beauty is, when the unit is switched on, there's a beautiful light which falls through these ventilation holes. So it just creates a beautiful pattern on the table or the newspaper which is lying around, or papers which are lying around. So what happens is, one is, it's performing as a WiMAX, but it's also saying that, look at me, at times. And this started looking quite nice. So this has that architectural element of typical aluminum clad buildings. I mean, you go to all the software parks, these are the kind of buildings you would get to see. And yes, this is now produced in India. We've sold over 100,000 units in the first, Yes, correct. No, luckily, okay, we were working with the Telsima team, who had an antenna designer. So our product would have looked horizontal. So we convinced him, it's a good point you raised. We designed what the product should look like first, and then the electronics guys came in. That's the other way around. You know, instead of they giving us, this is the electronics, this is the antenna, build something around it. So if they give me a rectangle PCB, I'm going to build a rectangle box. So here we actually visualized what the product should look like. And then the electronics people, we had lots of fights, because every mm had to be played around with. Because the minute the antenna size goes up, my diameter goes up, my widths go up, the proportions get lost. So this was quite a tough project, and we actually managed to complete this in about 4 months, sitting with the electronics team at Telsima. This product is actually doing quite well in the US. Here, we still have the issues of signals for our WiMAX. So the one in India, if you buy a BSNL or a Reliance WiMAX, this is what you would get. If you heard of a product, this was about 12 years back, a product called Simputer. Has anybody heard of Simputer? It's a very interesting project. It actually, I believe that it was ahead of its time. And it's a fully functional, it's like a computer. But the minute they came to us and said that we want you to design a laptop. So what gives it a visual language? Everyone knows this is a laptop. It's got a folding LCD panel. And when we found out what the application of what the end use for this laptop is going to be, it's going to be for school children. And the product should be under $200 was the criteria. So if you give a laptop to somebody who does not even have a table and chair to sit on, try sitting with a laptop cross-legged in a school scenario. You can't use a laptop. So what we did was, we actually shadowed some students and saw how they were using existing laptops. These are in Indian schools, municipal schools. Plus, we are also looking at the Brazil market. So this is what our product looked like. It's the whole derivation is from a slate. That's what you start with, at least. And the visual proportions are like a slate. And there's a LCD which can pop out, change the angle. It's got a friction hinge like any other laptop. But the convenience is you can actually sit on the cross-legged and use this. It becomes very simple. So we also started brainstorming with the team saying that why should it be restricted only for schools? Can it have different applications on the same platform? I don't know whether you can see it, but there's an area for a biometric sensor here. This product currently is at the third level for the UIADI for approval because we've also got a dual camera. So I can actually take your picture, thumbprint, and issue your UID card as well. We've also done the whole thing for financial intrusion where on both the sides, we've actually got card readers. The other side is for duplicating and one is for standard. So today, guys like ILNFS and all are using this for microfinance in the rural areas. We've already sold something like 500 units to Central Bank of India, which are taking it to the field now. So this is an ideal tool for guys who are on the field. It becomes very simple and weighs 800 grams. It's actually faster than my Sony Vaio. The beauty of this is it's also got either a CDMA or a GSM card. You don't need a dongle. So you can connect, upload the data online. That becomes very, very important. And the beauty of this computer technology is, today this laptop of mine uses 150 watts. What this uses is 3.5 watts. That's an Indian technology. So look at the battery life. You're looking at a 9-hour full video capability battery. I mean, this, you can actually see a movie for 9 hours without the battery draining completely. And we've got a very small battery. It's a lithium-ion battery. So that's the technology which the computer guys developed, which is an amazing. So we are just back riding on their technology. What happens in India? I mean, we have such a diverse cultural and language issues in India. If I have to sell this in rural, let's say Tamil Nadu or Karnataka, can I? What we've done is, like the iPhone, we've got a monochrome touchscreen here. So the same footprint or the same mounting points for a mechanical keyboard, we've designed an LCD with the same mounting points. So imagine I'm selling this in, let's say, Manipur. I have just a language selection, Manipuri. So the entire virtual keyboard is in Manipuri language or Tamil language. It actually opens up a lot of avenues. And that's not rocket science. I mean, Apple has done it already. Another advantage with this is this comes with a bag, and we're actually working on a very interesting project. We've got solar. This entire thing, incidentally, I forgot to mention, it works on solar power. So we've got something slightly smaller than the A4 letterhead, which is our solar panel. It's not glass. It's a fully flexible panel. That's the beauty. So it weighs only 28 grams, but it charges our laptop. So what you do is you're sitting in the classroom, just put the panel outside with the cable. That's about it. This is how the, and plus this is a touchscreen as well. So that's another advantage. And we're retailing this. It's just, I mean, right now it's more of an institutional sale, but eventually this will come in the Chromas of the world for under 10,000 rupees. Have you seen it? But very sluggish, very sluggish. This you will not even realize it's as good as this. It's their own proprietary thing, and we are not using Windows. It's all open source. That's where the cost also goes down. Okay, this is another project which we did for Larsen & Toubro. Initially, they gave me the PCB saying that we've developed an electronic tariff meter for energy. So the minute they gave me a rectangle, we designed something which slightly looks better than a normal rectangle box. We tried convincing them, saying that, you know, you're going to spend X amount of rupees on the tooling. Whether you tool a rectangle or whether you tool a fresh looking product, it's going to be almost the same, marginal 10% here and there. Finally, they accepted what we were saying, and this is what the product which they launched look like? It didn't say look at me, it didn't say I'm a high-tech product. This is what our product looks today. We've actually designed what the product should look like, and then the electronics was developed later on. But it's a very interesting case where I'm going to show you. We had these two, can you see these two circles here? One is to put the optical sensor. So a guy goes, opens this, puts the optical sensor, downloads the reading. What is the other one doing? So initially, frankly, we didn't get involved too much in the electronics. They told us there's a place for this. This is a area for a battery to be put, LR2281, which is almost like a 1 rupee coin flat battery. And that costs 2.8 dollars each, Maxell. So my first question after we tooled it, launched the product, I asked the electronics people saying that why are we using a battery? The reason is the probe which downloads this reading requires power. So if it's an energy meter, can it not draw power from the energy meter itself? But the step down cost was higher than using a battery. So eventually, now what we've done, we've removed this, blanked this out in the new version, and we've designed a probe with a battery built in. So if I'm selling 100,000 of these units, I'm selling only 1,000 probes. So that much less volume of battery. So look at the amount of saving just by a simple idea of including the battery into the probe. And globally, everyone has the battery in this. I don't know why. You take Schneider, you take n number of energy meters, most of the batteries are with the unit. So this saved a lot for L&T. So this is a more high-end, it's actually ready for a wireless. Unfortunately, the ecosystem, as we were talking, is not ready in India. So someone like BSES is now, we are working with BSES to make this fully wireless. So even you can log in and see your consumption of your power today. This also can give you an SMS alert. See, typically, it's very crazy. In places like Bombay, nuclear families, husband, wife goes for work. And you have these maid servants who come in the afternoons. You'll be surprised, they switch on your acons and relax. So the minute there's a deviation in your power consumption, it's going to send me an alert. So I know nobody's at home, but why is the AC on? So those kind of informations can be done by this unit. It's fully an embedded device. There's a division of L&T called MSIS, which works only in embedded products. Okay, this was a very interesting, I think most of you must have heard of Cypress Semiconductors. They're the largest semiconductor manufacturing company. So they came to us saying that we want you to design a wireless pneumatic thermostat. And it has to replace the current pneumatic thermostats, which are there in air conditioners for HVAC. Or rather, it's mainly meant for HVAC applications in huge malls and common air conditioners, you know. So you're walking into a big mall, the air conditioning and the heating and air conditioning will be monitored by this device. And it has to take not more than 3 minutes to retrofit a current product, because the market is in the US and US labor cost is very high. So this is what our actual product looks like today. It would have looked like one ordinary boring square or a round or a rectangle box, but I don't know, it's getting washed out. It's got very nice waves. You can see it. So I can't see it from here. So this is the actual antenna. So this is placed somewhere in the mall, and the entire air conditioning is monitored through this device. And eventually this product actually has managed to save 33% of energy cost. And it's a very nice thing on the website today. President Obama has made this mandatory in each and every government office by 2013, December. So which is very interesting. But see, basically it senses and gives a control to the, it's a variable drive for the air conditioning system. So what it does, it's just sensing and conveying. This also has the antenna. See, how we get projects is very interesting. Most of our work is word of mouth. The guys who work with Telsima the person who was in charge of design of the antenna, he quit Telsim and joined Cyprus, and that's how we got the project as well. So he's the same person who's designed this antenna. This you can actually see, we've got this single product received 6 awards in the US last year. Just 3 micro switches underneath with an LCD panel here. EPA BX systems, the most boring looking products. So when you walk into office, you never see them. It's hidden somewhere behind the reception area. So the client loses his market value. His products are never seen. Though it's not embedded, but it is hidden. So this is typically what a EPA BX looks like. Metal, powder coating, hand fabricated, texture powder coating or smooth powder coating, that's about it, nothing else. So we convinced our client saying that, are you ready for a radical change? But this client was very vocal by saying, I've already spent a lot of money on getting the CE certification and FCC for the PCBs. I cannot afford to invest a single extra rupee in the new PCB development. If you say, give us a round PCB, we'll not be able to do it. Are you willing to take on the project? So we actually took it as a challenge, and the logo of the company is 9 ellipses. So we've actually designed the whole product using his logo. So one is he directly gets a visual brand. People know that this is Matrix now. And the only product area which you need to open is for the junction area. So only one small component has to be opened up. You can do all the wiring. After this, we did a range of about 18 products for the same client. Actually, there are matte and gloss lines on this, but on the same principle. See, again here, what you are seeing is we've used still a square or rectangle PCB, but I've increased the areas on the side to give it a form. This is not a handheld device, so creating a compactness in the product was not an issue. It's going on the wall itself. But the idea is that here there's a cantilever component which hides all my cables. I hate to show the D-type connectors and all, or RJ45s. So that's the same flap you would see here in the molding. This is a largest, it's a 64 incoming line and 500 outgoing lines. So an organization like Tata Motors would use just one of this, or maybe IITs. That's the amount of lines you must be having, I think. Okay, coming to some very interesting projects. See, eventually design is all, whether you're working on an electronics product or anything, it's all about observations and nothing else. So L&T called us to redesign this equipment. Very interestingly, they actually told us that our sales are not good because the product is not, you know, it doesn't attract the doctors. Doctors, you know, are exposed to such modern looking equipment. So what we started asking, and can you believe this is injection molded? So somebody with a sheet metal background has actually worked on the plastic component. So he has tried to create sheet metal form through plastics, which one should never do. That's what we believe in. If you're using plastic, say it's plastic, show that it's a plastic product. If you're using metal, don't try and emulate and create it like a plastic product. So the first question I asked the biomedical guy is saying, why are the transducers of the probe on the right? They didn't take time to answer it. They said it's because GE, Siemens, Philips, Toshiba, Shimatsu has it on the right. These are the 5 global players who dictate the medical equipment domain globally. So I said, wonderful. Then there's a trackball and 3 buttons on the left to freeze the frames and give you an X-ray output. My second question is, what if I was a left-handed radiologist? The answer is very simple. Age 24, you're getting into radiology as masters after MBBS. It's a global phenomenon, or it's a known fact that you're supposed to use your right hand. You're supposed to learn to use your right hand. That led to the innovation, and that led to the entire change of the product architecture itself. This is what the product looks today. This is currently the world's only ambidextrous project product. So today the transducers can be kept on either side. There's a trackball right in the center. What we've done is we've just mirrored these three buttons. How much does it cost to add this much in your electronics? Peanuts. It's just three silicon buttons and gold contacts at the base on the PCB. But it's going to ask Dr. Kavi Arya Singh that are you a right or left-handed user for the first time. The next time he logs in and if he's said he's a right-handed user, the second time these three buttons will disable through software. So accidentally if he presses it, it's not recording a frame. That made a major impact. And 70% of our export out of 100% which L&T manufactures goes to France. So why France? French, we realize, are the highest left-handed users globally. So this has become a major boon. So today the transducers can be kept on either side. What is not important as a process is the gain control, just to change the contrast. So that you can do with left or right, so it's centrally aligned. So design is nothing else but just pure logic as well, which is same in your electronics. What you do, you also try and shrink sizes, you also try and reduce complexity at the user's end, I believe. As L&T brand, L&T medical division. Yes, absolutely. It's slowly moving. See, but typically what happens is medical division is the smallest group in L&T. So what they're doing is in the business, they're trying to hive off the smaller businesses which are under 1,000 crores, typically. So, you know, guys like Hitachi and all are have shown interest in buying them out. If you actually, this looks the sleekest in the world. This looks the sleekest. See, it's very simple. What you're seeing is this is like a PC cabinet, but I'm showing the front axis. So visually it's seen less. The minute I show a horizontal, see what happens. So visual, it's nothing to, we've not changed the electronics inside here. It's the same electronics inside here, but the axis has been changed. The only area which we changed the electronics is this area. They had to make a new electronics for the console. Because this console swivels on both sides. But today this looks far more modern even than Philips. Philips, the ultrasounds are 18 years old. This is now 10 years old. So we are a shade better in those areas. Very interesting. See, this is retailed at about 5.5 lakh rupees. Sony and Philips are the only two global companies which have just launched LCD for diagnostics. The cost of an LCD which is 19 inch is about 2.5 lakhs. This is a standard CRT with 100,000 lines. So what happens is your resolutions are very, very higher. It's not like a normal CRT. This alone, we I think 15 inch, it costs 65,000 rupees even today. I mean, nobody can dream of a CRT costing that much today. But these are high resolution CRTs because it's a monochrome. So that's one of the hindrance to go to an LCD. Because then that price will shoot it up to about 7.5 lakh rupees for the unit itself. Then people would go in for the Doppler, which we've again done. So you just press a button here and you can swivel it on either side. And it's like a clutch brake mechanism release. So typically, let's say I need to check the other side of the patient. I don't have to invert him. I can wheel this on either side of the patient. If you walked into any radiology room, this unit is always kept on the farthest left side because the unit is on the left. Whereas if you walk into any radiology room which has bought this equipment, the bed is always in the center. The patient is in pain, not the doctor. So I can just wheel this on either side of the patient. So you're giving comfort to the patient as well as the doctor. So that was something very important. Then we graduated to a Doppler, which is again, this is the only. See, today, obviously with competition, Philips has come up with where you can put the probe on either side. But this is what is holding them back. This is patented by us. So people are waiting for 4 more years for our patents to expire. That's about it now. Even today. This is the only product which is ambidextrous. See, now there are products which you can put the probe on either side, but the trackball using a left hand is the most important part. Then we graduate to a Doppler, but you know, all these products say I'm injection molded, right? They look plastic. And you'll be surprised, this is tooled right here at Pavai tool room. Sorry, here, right? Pavai tool room. We realized, you know, L&T Pavai has good equipment, but they were making small components. But the investments for bigger machines were already done. So why not tool it in-house? Again, the ambidextrous look and feel remain the same. But I don't know, has anyone got examined on an ultrasound or a Doppler ever? The minute you walk in, why is the room so cold? They maintain it at 20 degrees. Why? It's really not required. It's just a mindset issue there. Correct? Okay. None of these are like PCs. You can use it in ambient temperature, these equipment. And the funniest part is, you're already scared because you're walking into a clinic. So mentally, you're scared to go there because you don't know what the diagnosis is going to be. And the worst is, when they put the gel, there's a spasm. So what we've done is, can you see this? This is a very simple device. This is a derivative of the mosquito repellent. It's a ferrite inside, which just heats up the gel without changing the viscosity. So the minute I put the gel, there's a soothing effect. So you make the patient feel comfortable. This is what I would say is a human element in the design. So you make the patient feel comfortable. End of the day, anything to do with medical is all to do with psychology and nothing else. So all the electronics here is developed by EMSYS for L&T. It's in the same campus in Mysore. We've also worked on the interface. Okay, I'll quickly run through this, but this is one of the biggest pride which we have. We are the sixth nation in the world and the only company in India which makes a cardiac cath lab. And it's just as a crow flies from here, it's less than 35 kilometers. This is just at the start of the expressway driving to Pune, opposite the McDonald's. Our product actually looks more friendlier than Philips, GE, Siemens, Toshiba, Shimatsu. All the five companies don't like me because we're working as a competitor for all their products today. A typical cath lab setup would cost about 3.6 crores in India. And today angioplasty is like high-tech plumbing. I mean, you have a chest pain, you end up having a angioplasty. It's like high-tech plumbing and nothing else. If you see the Siemens product or other competitive product, they feel it's going to eat up the patient. They're very scary looking products, and this is C-arm which is rotating. Plus, interestingly, there's a small pivot here, and the whole C-arm actually pivots by 270 degrees on 135 on either side. We realized we launched this product, the target, we said we should at least be somewhere around 60% of their cost, lower. We ended up launching this product for 1.2 crores. Zero compromise on imaging. Because if a doctor does a procedure and the imaging is not correct, he doesn't want to listen the next day saying that so-and-so patient died on his table. So imaging cannot be compromised. So the only product which is really imported in this, or we outsourced it, is the image intensifier, which is from a company called Thales. They're like Rolls-Royce in image intensifiers. So, we are the first Indian company. This is 100% import substitution. No, not only that. There's a lot of markup with the multinational companies. I mean, if we can sell this with a handsome profit for 1.2 crores, handsome profit, I'm saying. 3.6 crores. See, in India, the duty, they have a duty structure which is 110%. Correct. We've got very handsome, that's what I'm saying. We also earn royalties on this, which is interesting. So, you know, the main point is there's a pivot, and operation theaters are very protein rich areas. So, you know, the design had to be rat free. They love PVC cables, all the rats. So what you're seeing is just a 10 mm gap all across. Our biggest hurdle came is when we were installing these at one of the most renowned hospitals. You'll be surprised, we didn't get a zero gradient flooring in India. That became a biggest challenge. So every hospital who ordered this, we had to give them a pre-warming to create the flooring. So that started getting a problem. So one day we just had a brainstorming with the client saying that why the hell should it be so complex? It's all motion control. What you're doing is controlling from here, everything. And these are capacitor switches, you can wash it down. That's the beauty. So we told him that doctors, when they see the x-ray, they know whether to keep the C-arm on this axis of the bed or this axis. Once the procedure started, they never change the axis. The pivot is done initially. So why can't they manually place it on wheels? So that led to the world's only product, which is a mobile cath lab. So when I say mobile, is this is the RF bed. We are just moving the C-arm from here to here manually on wheels. Look at the footprint size, it goes down. My entire electromechanical complexity went down. Our weight went down. And this is the world's smallest cath lab. So on the same cath lab, I can do fluoroscopy, angiography, angioplasty. So what do you... No, not the bed. Can you see these wheels? See, the bed has got a slide. These are air slides. So this, there's a brake here. You just press the brake, move it around. The bed is moving only in a single axis, whereas this C-arm, otherwise, was rotating along around this pivot to make it perpendicular. So if I'm the C-arm, I'm either here or I'm here. It's only two options which are required, because you need to know from which side of the groin. I mean, it's an entry for the from the groin for the catheter, nothing else. So it all depends on where the blocks in your heart are, nothing else. So interestingly, you know, we spend more than 60% of our time in operation theaters now. It's very interesting, you know, the patient is wide awake, the doctors are chatting, singing away, because their interest is to keep the patient active and talking, because they want to know when the spasm happens. When the stent is deployed, there's a spasm. The doctors are happy. If you've anesthetized, you'll never get that spasm. So reactions, again, this is a very human element which can't be checked on the monitor. You see the stent expanding and all that, but that spasm is most important here. So from 1.2 crores, this is a product for 75 lakhs. So what you're doing on 3.6 crores, this is sold for 75 lakhs. This is like the airport trolley. It's a clutch brake. You press the handle, move it around, release it. No rocket science. There's no pivot anymore. These are self-aligning, we've also got a spirit level, self-aligning casters. That too anti-static. We can't afford a static charge as well on this. See, pivot moves on one point. So if I have to keep a clearance, I need to create a more distance, because a gradient of the flooring is not correct. It has to be zero gradient flooring. This will always, the C-arm will always align itself. So the beauty now today is this has moved to smaller villages. Mechanically. Simple. Very simple mechanism. See, the simpler thing is the C-arm now is based on the motion control. What you're doing is only moving it once. No, it's not. It's just got beautiful casters with a fulcrum and a spring. So it just aligns itself. So it's like a mechanical accelerometer. It's a very simple thing. There's a weight which moves on one side. Simple. Olden days or in these godowns, you see this measuring equipment which slides. That's it. Obviously, when there is a success in the projects, your competitors don't like you. So a single order was 110 units from rural Karnataka, I mean Karnataka government. So you can imagine what plight our competitors would have, guys like Philips, Siemens, Toshiba, Shimatsu and GE. Finally, when they saw the quantities going up and the volumes going up, they bought this company, Philips bought this company Lock, Stock, Barrel 2 years back. So we had a target of 200 cath labs a year. Just because of Philips intervention today, it's 1200 plus. That's the muscle they get in, marketing muscle. No. So now it's, what we've done is we've just redesigned two components to give it a Philips language. See, it was very important when we were designing all this equipment, our product should not look like GE, Siemens, Philips, Toshiba, Shimatsu. I had to de-school ourselves to make it look like a Philips product then. So one is through color. Second is, what is Philips language is very smooth curves and all that. So I don't know whether I have that image, but no, I don't have that image. So what we've done is we've changed only this component and painted this in blue and white. That's the Philips colors, light blue and white, very boring colors, but it's Philips identity now. So the whole team is part of Philips now. This was another very interesting project. This again, out of box thinking, reason being, when you go to a pathology lab, he injects out 3 cc of blood and calls you in the evening to get the report, right? So what he's doing is he's taking that and putting into independent cuvettes and putting different reagents with micropipettes and doing everything manually. That's why it takes time. The actual chemistry does not take time. This was a client who called us in saying that Hitachi are the world leaders and the fastest, which has fully automatic blood testing equipment. This is clinical chemistry. So what happens is these are the reagents in the cuvette. This is where the cuvettes with the blood samples are kept. And this is a laundry. So all our competitors had all the 3 carousels in the same axis. So there's a robotic arm which aspirates the reagent, moves on the left, injects into the blood, goes ahead, cleans with steam thrice, goes back fast. By the time the reagent has indexed, picks up another reagent, the blood sample is changed, inject. So when it's a 3 circle, why not a central pivot? I think this is basic geometry, 6th standard. So our entire belt drives went off. So as a designer, we forced the mechanical and the electromechanical people to change the entire mechanism to a central pivot. So this is the arm which aspirates. So imagine it's just moving by not more than 45 degrees, injecting or aspirating the reagent, moving fast, injecting into the blood, goes, so it completes a 360 degrees. So it's a servo-driven aspirating arm. So belt drives, so my failure modes go down. So because of this, our size went down, our speeds went up, and our accuracies went up. We launched this product in 2001, Medica in Germany. And my client was highly cost conscious. He said, Satish, we should get 4-5 orders so we recover the cost of travel to Germany, exhibition cost. That's the mindset he had. And on the second day, we got a single buyer for 300 units from US. And that changed the whole scenario for the company. This was a policy decision that this is a 100% EOU now. So it's produced right here in Siebes. It's what, 3 kilometers as the crow flies from here? And it's not seen well, but even in the Hitachi or Rohema, which is the German company, you have to remove these ampoules to see how much reagent is left. So one of our team member, Falguni, who's also my wife and she's a communication designer from NID, she works on the UI, she said, what nonsense, I should be able to press a button and say, this is the volume in each and every reagent. So the minute you say scan volume, it shows the level of each and every reagent. A lot of computation and electronics had to be modified rather added on to do that. One is we're doing photometry for blood, so why not for reagents? So the readings are done photometrically. So now that we know the reagent, see, one advantage here is I don't need to now physically do any volumetric testing. It's showing me the levels through sensors. And one advantage is now that I know the level, it gives me an early warning saying that reagent number 18 is being consumed more, so replenish it or keep it in stock. Let's say there's a specific epidemic which goes on and you need only one kind of trial on the blood. This can handle 16 tests per sample. At times you don't require all 16 tests. And now that it also shows the level, it gives me the actual cost of each test. So hemogram, if you just want hemogram or HbA1c, it will say that reagent number 21 so many microliters, 18 so many microliters. It will tell you the cost of each test is so much. That's the beauty. And it's done, everything is done in Mumbai. Eventually, this is what the product looks. One is 70% plus operators in any pathology labs are ladies. Make the product feel comfortable to them. Whereas the balance, 30% male pathologists should not feel they're working with a feminine product. So I use the visual language of a washing machine. We actually said, let it look like a white goods product. So we didn't want any sharp corners, no handles, no nothing protruding out. So it gives a very soothing effect. I don't know, have you heard of you must have seen these ads called Thyrocare in the papers, full page ads, Thyrocare. What this product does, the Thyrocare is right behind Leela in Mumbai. So as the crow flies, it's less than a kilometer from the international airport. Thyrocare handles over 100,000 blood samples a day from entire Southeast Asia and India in the night shift alone. So blood samples are loaded into a pre-barcoded Kuwait, shipped, let's say on Singapore Airways or Jet Airways, 6:30 in the Singapore time. So 11:30 India time it reaches the lab, 12:30 the report is up on the web. So before the doctor wakes up in the morning in Singapore, the report is already there. That's what is happening. So you may be paying 800 rupees or 900 rupees for your whole blood count. What it costs is 200 plus, that's about it. So even in Mumbai, you'll be surprised, the blood samples from a small lab are going to Thyrocare. He's bought, I think, 40 of these machines now. This is a patient monitoring system. I think I'll run much faster on this. This is a very interesting product. Based on what parameter of the patient you need to monitor, you just plug that in. These are hot pluggable devices. There's a bus bar at the back, so you just plug it in. But the interface, see, unlike in the West, doctors in India move from one hospital to the other hospital as consultants. So one hospital, let's say Leelavati has HP Agilent system, the other one has Olympus, the third one has something else. You know, doctors get confused, and you're talking about life and death, because these are used in ICU and CCU, critical care units and intensive care units. Doctors should not fumble which button to press for ETCO2 or which button to press for SpO2. So what you're seeing here on the console is the same in the remote. So one is through design, we're trying to reduce the human errors and the fatigue on the doctors. Secondly, the cost. I mean, this is the same component if it fits here, as simple as that. The only difference is we just print in 90 degrees. That's it. So there's a cost saving, and the intention is to reduce the human error. This was the first project, and Mr. Mukhija came into our office and kept this on the table and said, it's a medical product, you need not know what it does. How much would you pay for it? It's very interesting, a client talking in terms of visual language. It's got very heavy electronics embedded inside. Does it say that? See, this is a classic example for you students. Your entire team members saying that this is a very high-end product. Does it say I'm high-end? It's a classic example. This is a capnography unit which measures the end tidal at the alveolar level of the carbon dioxide. So the patient's lungs are monitored through this device. So what he does is, this is put near his nose, and it actually, he breathes into this, and there's a DM water solution inside. So there's a care to be taken that this device or this cartridge needs protection in transit and during use. So they sell this for 1,30,000. Does this CI cost so much, this product? So this is what our product looks today. Looks like a miniature coffee machine, small. But today, our cost increased by about 300 rupees because we had to amortize the tooling. But the selling price is 1,78,000. So this is what design can do. We've actually given a protection in transit and during use. It looks more friendlier. The patient's relatives also get confidence saying that our Johnny is on a good equipment. It's very important. It's all to do with cycle. It's the same scenario on our ultrasound and the Dopplers. See, on one side, we try and save the cost somewhere, but you know, on hindsight, I think a year and a half back, a friend of mine landed in our office after 18 years. You know, we had not met for 18 years, and I was showing him the kind of work we do. Said, "Oh shit, you've done this equipment." I can't believe it, because in Nagpur, my father got operated on your equipment, and we were told it's an imported equipment, and this is the world's most compact, and he charges a lakh more. You know, so on one side, we are trying to do something, and this is what happens. Nothing in our reach or control. This currently is the world's highest soil capnography unit. Mysore, they've got a new unit only to produce one single product, LNTs. So you walk into any hospital in US, what you're going to see is LNTs, ETCO2. Okay, I'll rush through these endoscope cameras. I'm not going to... See, the innovation here is, you know endoscope, right? Non-invasive or minimal invasive. So what they do is they drill multiple holes, 13 mm holes, put the camera, put the light source, put the tongs, chop your appendix, take it out. What we've done is we've integrated the light source with the camera. So one 13 mm hole gets reduced to be drilled. That much less trauma on the patient, that much faster recovery. And it's got the entire camera and white balance. This is a heavily loaded electronics inside this grip. We've designed a universal camera instead of having... normally you have four different types of cameras, we've integrated that into a single. That became a major advantage when you're doing a procedure. Okay, just... Prism. Basic prism is what we've used. So, yes, that's it. It also moves slightly. So the focal length is changed. No, we came up with this idea, but the whole research happened at my client's place. See, because they have optics lab, which we don't have. So what we do is, again, it's purely a teamwork, nothing else. There's another project which I'm going to share, which is the whole project is what ideation has come from us, but there was a team of over 200 people working on that project for 13 years, is what I'm going to share. But based on a very simple germ of an idea, which we threw in them to at our client's table. User interface, you know, the product is very high-end. It's again for the endoscope image capturing. These are world leaders called Stryker in the US. This, what you're seeing is a 10.1 diagonal screen. It's a touch screen. And Falguni was asked to redesign the GUI. And they also said that eventually we are going to shrink the size to a 10 by 14 centimeters. So almost half of this size. But the information to be supplied on the screen is the same. So the first thing which she thought is, this is an on-off switch. That's the only thing in color. The first intuition was, she thought that's an on-off switch. They were shit scared to use color. Why are you spending for a color TFT only to have Stryker there? She said, I don't want Stryker there. They were offended by saying, you know, we are the world leaders, we want Stryker there. Damn it, the patient is anesthetized. He's least bothered what he's chopped on. He does not know what he's being operated on. So finally, what she did was, she actually studied each and every process from start to beginning of any non-invasive procedure, and came to these five or four major points. This is our opening screen. This is a 10 by 14 touch screen. The doctor's interested in knowing whether it's a new case, current case, or he can quickly check how he had operated on somebody's hernia or appendix 6 days back. He can quickly do that, or he can load the patient info. This is actual operative screen now. Thanks to mobile phones, today anyone knows what icons are, you know. It's very simple. That this for save, this for shoot, or capture. That's become very simple now. And believe me, operation theatres are extremely tensed environments. Doctor's job is to focus on the patient, not to figure out how to press to go to a single camera. You know, this is very confusing for the nurses and the operation theatre attendants, as well as the doctors. So the fatigue is very high on the surgeons and the technical staff. This does away with that. See, this is a toggle switch. Now you can know it's between a single camera and double camera. So the minute you press single, this gets lighted up and you see a single camera image. So the fatigue goes down. See, striker is there on the equipment, just in case, for argument's sake, you don't require to use that FSI. It did away with 13 languages because this product used to be offered in 13 languages. And the beauty of using the icons is it opened out all the non-English speaking countries also. So, I don't know whether you can read it, but the testimonial is 44% sales went up just by the change of UI. We've not done the change in the hardware as yet. Now we are getting into that stage. Okay, this is a very small, I call it an embedded project, because there's a lot of thought which has gone in. I know, have you seen this product called the Tata Swatch? So right now what you're seeing is just a container, plastic, no big deal, should be completed in 6 months. This is a 9-year research project. We actually went much, much deeper into the technology. And what we call, this is called the Tata bulb, which is a filter. Why bulb? Because in rural areas, you can easily say, go, jaake Tata bulb leke ao. You know, it becomes very simple. When you call it a cartridge, it becomes complex for a rural person. The technology here is extremely interesting. This is the only product which does not use electricity but switches off after 3000. So your service life of the cartridge or the bulb is 3000 liters. So its job, once you've loaded the cartridge or the bulb, it will purify 3000 liters. We've got a safety factor of 10%. But minimum what it's going to filter is 3000 liters. Unlike other cartridges, like you have, let's say this is a cartridge of any filter, water gets inside from the top, goes from the bottom after getting filtered, right? In our case, it goes from the side, rises up. So what we've done is we've actually increased the residence time, because what it contains is rice husk ash, which is abundantly grown in India. People pay us to collect the rice husk. Rice husk otherwise is a nuisance. And we've doped it with silver nanoparticles. So I want the water molecules to have a better affinity and better exposure to the silver nanoparticles. So what happens is it's got a reverse flow. So water enters from here, goes from the sides, passes through, can you see a very small venturi here? Passes through this. So what you're seeing here is a full transparent test tube kind of plastic component. But this is something like a chalk. If I dip a chalk in water, it's going to dissolve, right? But this is like a chalk, it breaks like a chalk, it writes like a chalk, but dissolves in only a single axis, micron by micron. So as the water flows, it dissolves. And there's a compression spring which opens up, and there's a small Morse taper here which will eventually close off that hole, the venturi. That's it. So after 3000 liter, when the chalk dissolves fully, it closes off. No way you can reuse the cartridge. You can't shake it under water and reuse it. You're forced to change the cartridge. Typically in Indian scenario, what happens, people are careless when it comes to water. They don't know the difference between water and drinking water. So they just clean it under tap water and you can't see bacteria. So here we are enforcing that people get the right quantity, quality of water. No, that's again, you know, the way Tata's work is very different. I mean, we did this project with an organization called Tata Research Development Design Center in Pune, TRDDC. You know that cup-shaped building in Hadapsar. So we did the, I could have shown you the whole genesis. We built the prototypes using buckets. For 4 years, we just monitored health waterborne diseases in 70 villages all across India. In 70 villages, as I was saying. So you're using our prototype, I'm not, but we are neighbors, our water source is the same. So there are MBBS doctors, pathologists who are monitoring waterborne diseases in the entire village. That's the work which happened for 4 years. Then the design started. You know, so initially we got more into design of the filter medium. And initially it was cement, pebbles and whole lot of things. We realized this is not suited for mass production. If you have to sell and cater to the Indian market, you have to do something which is faster and easier to produce. So that's when the research on ricerous ash started. It's a disposable after 3,000 liters. It will cost you 299. You'll be surprised. This is less than 10 paisa a liter. See, again, there's an incentive scheme. The minute, that's what is happening now. Right now, we've already sold about more than 5 lakh units in the last 16 months since it's launched. And the minute a villager goes back with the old cartridge, he may get 60 rupees off or something like that. That's what we are, I mean, Tata Chemicals is working on. Okay, why Tata Chemicals? Yeah, sorry. Wonderful question. See, basically, even Silver Nano has an exposure time. I can't recharge the ricerous cache with Silver Nano again. It basically is governed by the filter medium. That's all. And this is like showing the end of life. The chalk is just like an end of life. It's an indicator. Because when you actually see the red moving down, the villagers know kitna abhi baki hai. Half baki hai, three-fourth baki hai, or 10% is left. Now we've also done marking further on that. So it is basically based on the, let's say, the charge of the silver nano onto ricerous cache. Okay, this is something which, please stop me if you get bored. This is a very interesting project. We are doing that parallelly right now. See what has happened, the attendance in school has improved. The kids' absenteeism has reduced. So there are marked differences which is happening slowly. See, one is this is the only idiot-proof product. You cannot make a mistake in assembling it. That's the beauty of this product. And whatever water you put, did you like the taste of the water? It's activated carbon. It's just getting... Okay, unfortunately, it's my mistake. I should have got you the physical product to be shown. But, you know, again, talking of embedded systems. In embedded systems, what happens is you have very high-end technology to simplify a process, right? It does not get reflected out. It's like writing Intel inside. That's it. But this is a very complex system. What I'm showing you, this project, we started in 1998. With a client, an Indian, a proud Indian client. That's what I would say. And this is, everybody's seen these inhalers, right? Standard inhalers, which is lying on the table, or they take it out of the purse or bag and so these are some major players, Glaxo being the world leaders. I'm not going to go through too much, but the global change or the global trend is to move to dry powder inhalers. It's a multi-dose device which is 60 doses. Why? Because, I forgot that image. Sorry. Let me go back. This used to use a propellant called CFC. After CFC was banned, there's another propellant called HFA, which is not stable with many molecules. So people have started moving to dry powder inhalers. So what happens is, this has 60 doses in a strip, in a spool. Let's say it's a circular cartridge. You know, in Diwali, you have this revolver with crackers going tuck, 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 continuous. It's exactly like that. And the dose size is 2.5 milligrams. So you can't even see it in a pinch properly. So imagine when you have to inhale such a small quantity of powder, you actually require more force. Have you tried inhaling something which is very small? It takes more time. So what we did was we said, let's design a dry powder inhaler. So the heart of the dry powder inhaler is something called the airway, what we've designed. Reason being, I think I'll just skip all this. When you talk of automotive, you know, you say what is your average of the vehicle. So the consumption pattern per liter, how many kilometers you can travel. So how the inhaler is metered is basically, or rated, is what is the fine particle fraction. It's called FPF. So FPF means the amount of drug which reaches the alveoli. So the asthmatics start getting relief the minute that molecules reach the alveoli. So what it does, it dilates the capillaries to allow the blood to flow through, nothing else. So Glaxo, being the world leaders, has a fine particle fraction of 30, which is the highest. So what you inhale, only 30% reaches inside. And those pressurized pumps, what you see, only 18% is the, so your efficacy or your performance is 18% only. So we took a target of 50%, not knowing that there's a science behind it. So we told a client saying that, you know, we can complete this project in a year and a half. He laughed at us, and he actually sat with us and said, we are going to pay you to learn at our cost, which is very interesting. So for 13 years, we learned at the client's cost, and we realized the amount of work which goes into it. So what we said is 50%, then nothing should get retained inside the device. And we also said that, you know, it should work at a pressure drop of 60 lpm at 2 to 6 kPa pressure drop. Then we also said that it should be suited only for my client's formulation. So if I put Glaxo's drug in it, it will not function the same way. So there were too many hurdles in the whole project. So this is basically, it's an airway which is based on the principle how bullets are fired. This is 8th standard physics, conservation of angular momentum. So what we've done is, our drug molecule, let's say salbutamol, fluticasone, is about 5 microns. Inhaling 5 microns is very difficult. So what we've done is, we've agglomerated that with lactose, which is 40-45 microns. So what happens is, when we agglomerate it, the lactose gets coated with the molecules. So there's a bond which gets created through static. So when you inhale, you want it to create a turbulence, and the higher weight molecules go on the side. So when I inhale, it creates a turbulence, and only the drug molecules go inside and the lactose goes on the side. So this is purely targeted drug delivery. So there's a lot of mathematical modeling which had to be done to create a turbulence. I mean, this is nothing else but angular momentum, right? 8th standard physics. So we had to decide whether we wanted 3 inlets, 4 inlets, 5 inlets, 6 inlets. What should be the angle, entry angle, should it be tangential? The amount of work which has gone into this, we eventually prototyped, that is injection molded 27 airways with minor variations. So one is mathematical modeling, second is gut feel is very important, third is physically trying out the device. Today the success story is with 5 inlets, finally we realized our mathematical modeling and the actual prototypes matched beautifully. So that was a major success. We had to determine what should be the opening at the throat when you put it in your mouth, so that gaps are least. That is your inhaling air. Pressure drop and fine particle fraction. Eventually, we've achieved 50% plus when Glaxo is 30%. It's got zero device retention. The most important part is it is independent of breath profile. See, today you have to hold a breath, puncture, and then inhale. That requires a lot of training and coordination. And they already are having a problem to breathe in. That's a bigger problem. So in our case, the minute you inhale, I should have got the device to demonstrate. The minute you inhale, it actually punctures a blister and delivers. So it's independent of breath profiles. So again, the interface for this is all our earlier competitor products require 6 or 7 human steps or patient steps to be done. We've gone the Hero Honda way, which is fill it, shut it, forget it, right? So this is open, inhale and shut, only 3. So the interface is just 3. And what you're seeing is, you're seeing a number from 60, 59, 58, 57 in reverse fashion. So a user knows how many doses are left. So what you're seeing here is a design, a pattern, but only some of them actually allow the air to come inside. So when you inhale, that's the air required to operate my breath actuated mechanism, puncture the blister and deliver the drug. I'll just see if there's an animation. So again, this has got real huge technology embedded inside. It's got 27 components. So we are not bothered how complex it is to be made. But for the user, it's open, inhale, shut. You know, that's the end of the story. This is how you just open. Yeah, exactly. Click, click, every advance, right? See, what happens if you're visually impaired? You can't see how many doses are left. The last 8 doses, a small pin pops out. So when I feel the prick, I know that I need to buy a new device. As simple as that. So there are a lot of world's first things in this product. Last year, we had submitted a paper at the respiratory drug delivery in Arizona, where they get 100 plus papers and they shortlist 5 papers to be read in the conference. So last year, it was Glaxo, Eli Lilly, Pfizer, 3M in design direction. And we've rocked the boat and come. People cannot believe that this is a product from India and far more superior than Glaxo. Seeing our patents, we are about 7 years ahead of Glaxo. So that's in terms of technology. That's where we are today. And I take pride because a client is right in your neighborhood here. But it's very important to get a client who believes in design. This was a very simple idea which we worked with him. And it's spent about, 300 crores on this project in the last 13 years. That's the amount of work which has gone in. See, one is there are a lot of compliance and there's a lot of cost involved to get the compliance, you know, in pharma. And this is yet to get the FDA. So we are launching it in 18 countries. Then we will look at the US market. India alone is such a huge market. We're looking at over 50,000 units to be sold a month. Oh, let me play the video. Oops. Okay. I'll show it from a... Just to show you the complexity, I should have got a... I had a fully molded transparent device. You could have actually tried it out. So, you know, this yellow part, what you're seeing is the breath actuated... it's a diaphragm. The minute you suck air, it pressurizes the air on it and it hammers. And hammers and punctures a blister and it delivers the air through a reverse flow. So it creates a turbulence as well. And the powder comes out spinning. So the way bullets are fired. I'll just see if I have, this is what I believe in at times. Let me see if I can show you an animation somewhere else. See, open, air enters from here, operates a breath actuated mechanism. Can you see the thing spiraling out? So that was the airway. Oops, I don't like this. I'll play it in a. This has actually embedded in the file. I don't know why it didn't work. It was very interesting that we got to work with a person who was a real authority on CFD analysis, and he is a guy who works with a guy called James Dyson in the UK, and we partnered with an organization called Cambridge Consultants to the fine tuning of our design, because this is a full robotic assembly, no human being is inside, even for the drug filling and the full assembly, fully robotic assembly. And okay, I think happening in the background. So this is what a cartridge is. Sorry, I think this was a. Anyway, in short, this is the kind of work we do. But it's very interesting that, you know, you have to cross pollinate, talk to other disciplines, and not just stick to your, you know, what you're doing. I think that's something which is very, very important. Any questions? I don't know. And design is a good profession, no? Whatever graduation you do. There's IDC right here. Thank you, thank you. It's my pleasure, yeah.
We have a huge hunger in this country for new products, and it doesn't seem right to have to buy these things at about 5 times the cost from abroad. And I suspect what's increasingly going to happen is that in the process of trying to reverse engineer products, and there are a huge amount of products around us, we will come up with something even better than what's available abroad, because our constraints and price points are much more competitive. And if we can design for our own market, it becomes a global leader. As a possibility. Our needs are very different. All actually, are they really very different? Because everybody wants things at low cost,
no,
work efficiently, and things like that.
But it all depends on the culture as well.
Okay.
See, for example, that's where the difference is. In India, you have to cater to, you know, that it's going to be abused more. Whereas abroad, it's respected. I think one of the biggest challenge in India, we don't respect our country, a flag. That's one of the biggest challenge. Till then, nothing is going to happen. That's what I feel. See, I mean, okay. One is you go to China, they take pride to be a Chinese. How many of you take pride that you're an Indian? Oh, I'm glad things are changing. No, the problem till date is any product which is made in the West is the best, is the policy. There are n number of products from India which are actually better. Nike is produced in Chennai, but you like it because you buy it, you like the logo of Nike, right? When will we have our own Microsoft or our own operating systems? It's the Indians who are running that company here, literally. It's time we have something of our own. I mean, Infosys is far bigger than many, many other guys, but we don't have our own operating system.
That's because we are not training ourselves.
Exactly.
To identify problems and solve
exactly.
The problem.
No, or also thinking out of the box is what is happening, I think. Slowly it's changing. See, I'm going to share a very crazy project, which is the way we operate in our office is very different. That second and fourth Saturday is off. First and third Saturday, we don't touch client work. We just think of what, we identify problems and work around it. We fund our own projects and then eventually try and see if we can get funding to take it further. But one classic example is what I'm going to show you. How many of you know what a KT weir is? If you go to rural India, you see these villages with small dams. Those are called KT weir, and they typically look something, oh my god, it looks something like this. Oh, it's not seen. Okay, it's, there's a small dam here. The small dam with these gates which are inserted inside. It's a very common thing in rural areas. So typically in the Indian government wants to conserve water and save water and doesn't allow it to flow it in the rainy season. Our biggest problem is in rains, we have too much of rain, and a month after that the fields are lying dry. That's why the suicides are there. Farmers are not willing to do farming because there's no infrastructure. You know, but no point sitting and blaming the government. Government is too loaded with everything. So as citizens, I think we should take the onus of doing certain things now. You can ride a bullock cart or a cycle or a tractor, it depends on the weight. But this is a standard KT weir. What you are seeing here is a failure, the water is leaking. So after the rains, typically after Dashera in mid-October, now the seasons are changing. Unfortunately, September end is when the gates normally were installed 3 years back. Now things are changing. So there's a contract to remove the gates just before, prior to the rains. Around mid-May, and there's a contract to install the gates again. These are metal gates weighing 84 kilos, MS gates. So you can imagine when MS is inserted in water or exposed to water, what will happen? It's going to rust. So what happens is, there are goons who actually steal them before rusting. So government spends money to install these gates. Each gate weighs 84 kilos. So the width is 2100 mm by 500 mm. And there's a camber angle with lacing work, so to take the force. If you take a standard 2 meter high or 3 meter high dam, the load on the lowest needle, we call them as the gates or needles, is 35,000 tons. It's the load on the water. That's the water pressure. That's why these gates are removed in the rainy season. You can't arrest the flowing river. The dam is going to burst. So imagine. Can you see this? There is no intersect, joint, nothing. So water leaks. So end of the day, government is spending a standard 2 meter dam with 27 needle cost about 20 lakhs. Maharashtra alone has 37,000 dams. Do you know that? The statistics is horrible. India alone has 100,000 plus dams. More than 60% of them are defunct. So look at the amount of government spending which has gone waste. And the farmers end up committing suicide because they don't get water. And the dams are built for the farmers to retain the water. So post-rainy season, they get water. Now, one of the reasons why this attracts theft is it's MS. It can be, it has a resale value. But look at the leakages. I mean, look, if the farmers there are vigilant enough, in 2 years, they anyway rust. So it starts having pitting holes and water flows through anyways. Or some of the gates cannot be removed off at times. I'm just showing you some horrible conditions. This is how they're stored in the rainy season. See this gate, this dam we've been monitoring for the last 3 years, has been non-functional because one gate is stuck, nobody is bothered to take it out. So there's no water being stored in that dam. Look at the amount of spending of the government now. See the condition. So finally, we took a team and got it gas cut this year. So what we've done is we've actually decided, saying that the main reason why the gates are stolen because the material is MS, it can be resold. Let's create the gates of a material which has no resale value. So we've actually done LLDPE, which has no resale value. If I try and melt this, is like your buckets. But through design, we've actually achieved it. So what you're seeing is a fully functional molded, rotationally molded KT ware needle. No resale value at all. Absolutely no resale value. From eight. It's very interesting. Actually, I don't know whether you can see some holes being drilled here. See, if you try and oppose water, it becomes very difficult. What we've done is we've used, so the water pressure is on this axis, there's air on the other side, right? So we don't have an issue of buoyancy. If it was water on both sides, it would have come up because this is only 22 kilos instead of 84 kilos. So it's easy to install. So we allow the water to fill it up. So we're using the water weight. This is now almost 200 liters of water inside. So it's almost 200 kilos of water which is pressing it in. And it cancels out. That's the beauty. Because we've got kisses. I'll show you the molding from the rear side. And what we've done is water which comes up from here oozes out from here. So it's a cycle. So we're not allowing it to burst beyond a certain point. And this is a channel in which, see, this is a view from the rear. So these are like ribs. So it takes all the pressure. Because we call it a kiss off, where the top layer and the bottom layer comes in kisses. So it's like a welded joint in plastic. And it stacks one on top of each other. And we've developed a wedge. It's a tapered wedge which just is self-sealing. We don't require any gaskets, nothing. See, the failure may start when your gaskets are lost. What happens? You can't open the dam gates and reinstall. By the time the water flows off. So, you know, all these things had to be considered, and we purposely installed this in the last rainy season when the water was flowing at the highest peak to see how it fails. See, one is doing FE analysis, all that is fine, but end of the day you have to try it on site in a practical physical format. So we installed it in September when the river was really wild, and we knew where it was going to fail, and it failed only at that area. So this year we modified that and we know how it's going to work now. So these are the holes which fills up the water inside. And what you're seeing is this is the area for a plastic nut bolt. So when you have four or five of them, they become one mass, having injection molded nut bolts. And these are the areas to actually tie a rope and pull it up. That's it, as simple as that. Plus this is also used as a step ladder. So people actually climb up the dam through the water. Our first prototype, it was so exciting that we had only four needles molded, but we quickly built a temporary dam, and in 10 minutes we had the water stored. You know, that was a confidence. And then the whole dam was installed. And so from point A, we used to just dump it in the river. It used to come flowing to the dam, which became interesting. Now that gives us a problem, saying that this can have a reuse or some other use besides the gate. So not so simple to identify it. So now the dam is fully functional. What you're seeing is on the other side, the water is right till the top here. This being a civil work done by the government, we realized that our gates performed so well that the leakage started from the foundation. So it caved in from the foundation. So this year, using our money, we've actually repaired the whole foundation. So hopefully this year it will stop. But for 3 months till December end, we had water full. And it just burst from below. So there's a plinth which is constructed in concrete. That entire thing has caved in. So just open the top and you have the water flowing. So, you know, these are the needs which somebody in the Western world will never think of. You know, the concept of theft is not there. You design a beautiful garbage collection bin outside, the next day it will not be there. You know, so those are the some of the issues which are going to be a big problem for us.
This reminds me in Chandigarh, they're having a big, big problem because the old manhole covers, which have Le Corbusier's brand on them, are being stolen by young people in Mercedes cars at night, and they're well being seen in these auction houses in Europe, right? These manhole covers are actually being sold for lakhs and lakhs. I think it's 10, 12 or 15 lakhs per piece, right?
It's alloy. In
is that so? Okay. Any questions? Akshar? Okay. Anyway, thanks, Satish, for a most inspiring and exciting talk. And the underlying values which kind of underpinned this talk, especially this thing about being patriotic and, you know, be proud of being Indian and stuff like that.
No, we have it, but it's not coming out.
Yeah. But what's great is that people like him have made a start, and they are an increasing number of this tribe who are doing things better than anywhere else in the world. People say world class. I don't like that word because it means that we are trying to reach some limit set by other people. I'm saying that we should do something which is great, which is elegant in itself, and you don't have to ask anybody for a certificate. Like when you speak the truth, you know it's the truth. When you design something good, you feel good inside. So we feel that more of us should be in that kind of mold, you know, where we shouldn't have to ask somebody else for approval, is this good enough? You should be of that kind of caliber, right? So Satish has given us one instance of how this can actually work in an Indian context where you're creating products that are better than anything else in the world, and I hope that this should be an inspiring lesson for us. So thanks for having come.